Hello and welcome to Rendering the Metaverse Across Space and Time. So, quick introduction, who am I? I'm Angelo Pesce. I'm currently the Director of Rendering Engineering for Roblox. And in my past career, in past 15 years, I've worked for quite a few different companies, Electronic Arts, Activision, Capcom, Relic, and I shipped quite a few games, so I don't list them anymore. It's more than 10, 12, I think, titles. I'm also one of the co-authors of Real-Time Rendering, the fourth edition. And, well, you can find me on Twitter, and I have a blog where I sometimes write stuff. So let's just jump into this. And what is this going to be about? Rendering the Metaverse Across Space and Time, since very complicated title. So let's make it simpler. And really, this will be a short guide to the weird rendering of Roblox. So kind of surprise titles, which are we here? All right, so rendering in Roblox. I mean, if you know, really, if you have seen what Roblox is, it may seem like, is there even anything to talk about? Isn't Roblox mostly simple graphics and kids games? And it is true, like it is, it has a lot of kids playing it. I think it's more than 50% of the US kids, 9 to 12, are playing Roblox today. But it is definitely not just that. And even rendering that is not actually that simple. What I found interesting, and the reason why I'm giving this presentation, is that our problem set is almost entirely orthogonal to what we know from classic AAA console video games. And so this also means that it's much, much less explored. There aren't many titles, there aren't many platforms that operate in our space. So just as an example of what people do in Roblox, we actually do have an incredible community of creators, builders, that love to work and create artistic spaces inside Roblox. And if you like Google Roblox Showcase, you can find some of those creators. They really like to push Roblox to the limits to the degree that they have like nowadays automated ways of reverse engineering and looking into any change that we do for every new binary, so they can catch features even before we officially enable them. It's really a super passionate community. But those tend, of course, not to be massively multiplayer experiences, so they don't track millions of daily active users, but that does not mean that they are not a very important community for us that really creates something awesome with our engine. So what is Roblox really? Well, maybe you know that it's fairly big. We recently surpassed the 150 million monthly active users, huge population of kids playing it. But so if you have a kid, probably you've heard of it, but if you are my age and you try to open it, you probably don't really get even what it's all about and how to navigate that space. And they really wouldn't blame me. Like I don't get that either. I think it's just completely different generation. But we'll have to spend a little bit of time talking about what Roblox is and what it wants to be, a little bit of the philosophy about it, around it, because that really shapes the technical landscape and the kind of problems that in practice we'll have to solve and the kind of workflows and technical challenges. So let's dive into this. And one thing to understand is Roblox is really not an engine. When you think about an engine like middleware, you maybe pay some money, you get some code, and you use this to accelerate your product development. You want to make a game, you don't want to start from scratch, you take a third-party engine. For us, there will never be a way to get Roblox. I mean, not only I don't think that we will license the engine, but what would even achieve? Like, Roblox is not just the engine. Is the entire infrastructure, the cloud platform, but most importantly, is the community. Even if you could replicate the entire infrastructure, which would be really impossible, but it wouldn't be Roblox without the community attached to it. Roblox is also clearly not a game. And here is really a core idea. Like, we don't want people to play Roblox. We want people to play games that happen or have experiences being places that happen to be in our platform. We don't make content. There is no game, no even model or anything that we create. We really want to empower our community. We don't favor an aesthetic. We don't tie to a single genre. It's really a platform for creativity. The only thing that I guess it's one of the strong defaults is that we do default to third-person characters. We will see why. It is fairly reasonable given our social focus. We want to have avatars and we want you to like see your avatar, right? But even that you can completely override. And similarly, well, Roblox is not a virtual world, right? It's not, people don't join a single shared world. There, we don't even have a default lobby or space when you launch Roblox. It's just, you can browse other people's creations. Okay, so then what are we really trying to build? Well, Roblox is really a metaverse company. And what does this metaverse mean? It means that we want you to have your identity in Roblox. We want to be able for you to connect with others and connect with others through virtual experiences, virtual worlds that I can either browse or I can create myself. So if I have to make an analogy to kind of like, you know, explain it through, make it similar to something else out there, I would say that we definitely are not in the same space as, say, Unity, Unreal, or maybe Fortnite or Minecraft. I would take the closest analogy, and this is a very kind of personal interpretation, it's not an official statement, but to me, we are more similar to Instagram, or if you wish, to YouTube. We have a medium, in this case, Metaverse. We have a community of creators, and we have a social aspect to it. So, okay, Instagram may be like seeming very odd as a comparison, but if you think about it, it's really not. Like, Instagram never wanted to be a simpler Photoshop. And in the same way, we are not a simplified 3D engine. Instagram is really a place for creators to have their own identity, to represent themselves, to connect with others, and to connect with others through their creations. So this kind of seems very obvious today, but I remember when this came out, I was like, why? Like, why do I even have to share photos? Like, I can't save them. It's not just a regular photography app. It was very weird. And in a way, that is also why it's maybe a little bit daunting at first to see what Roblox want to be. So this is where there is a similarity with both kind of platforms of creativity, where you also have a representation of yourself. But there are, I think, tricky differences. First of all, if you talk about Instagram or maybe YouTube, right? Those platforms leverage medias that are very well defined. In one case, digital photos, in the other case, videos. In our case, our medium, what we call the metaverse, it's not something that exists canonically. It's something that we get to define. And the other difference is that the social interactions don't happen at a separate level from the creation, but you actually have those interactions inside the creations themselves. All right, so all that said, try not to spend too much time talking about those principles, but just to give a better idea of what we're talking about, what are the key ingredients that compose our platforms, at least the ones that will be relevant for the following discussion? So for me, the ingredients are those ones. We have what we call a data model. Let's see what that is. We have the client technology, where the engine lives. So this is the group that I'm part of. We have cloud services. We have a cloud infrastructure. We have an editor, so you can create something with it. And of course, there is this very strong and fundamental aspects on in our community. So what is the data model? The data model is really for us the description of the metaverse. It's the description of a virtual world. In a way, then again, if you have to operate through analogies, it's similar to the HLM DOM. It's A3 made of services, but it is for 3D worlds. And there are a couple of peculiarities. One thing that's interesting is that in this data model, we have a unified client-server concept. So you create objects and scripts in it, and those objects and scripts live in the same space, even if some will be server-side and some may be client-side or both. So simply put, you have control of which objects replicate from servers to the client. And the same goes with scripts. So scripts, by default, if you create a script in Roblox, it will be a server-side script. And any object that the server-side script creates is also sandboxed to be server-side. And this is for security, so people cannot like hack gameplay by modifying things locally in their clients. There is a concept of local scripts, and those should be used really for presentation things like camera or other aesthetic non-gameplay code. Simulation similarly is by default server side, but it's a little bit more of a hybrid. We can migrate a certain aspect of simulation on clients. I really won't go into the details of that, but that is a very interesting topic on its own. So this is the data model, representation of objects, scripts, all in the same space. And of course, similarly to the HTML DOM, it is dynamic. So scripts can continuously do changes and edit the world. And the rendering engine takes the data model to understand where the world is at a given point. The other component that we have other than this object DOM is our assets. And assets for us right now are things like images, mesh, sounds, animations. They're really immutable binary blobs that are delivered and stored in by CDNs. So they are a typical content addressable storage. You have a binary blob, you have a hash to it, the hash gives you the blob back. And most of those assets, they are made this way both because of optimized content delivery through CDNs, but also because we run moderation on the assets that people upload. In the data model, you don't reference directly those binary blobs, those hashes, but instead you reference asset IDs. And then we have services that resolve from a given asset ID the underlying binary blob. This allows us to resolve different binary blobs per platform or per version if we change formats of the underlying assets and things like that. So the flow goes, you have data model objects. Some of this, say like I have a mesh as an object in the data model, that mesh may refer to a mesh asset. And that mesh asset, when we want to retrieve it, we ask the asset service to get the corresponding hash of the binary blob, and then the CDN delivers it to the clients. All right, so this is kind of the representation, what the primitives of the metaverse. Then we have the client technology. The client technology, if the data model is similar to the HTML DOM, well, the client, then it's sort of a web browser. But then again, for 3D experiences. And really the Roblox client, what it provides is a window into a Roblox world. And by window, we will see what I mean a little bit later, but the idea is that different clients can really render or represent the same world in different ways. This depends on your screen, your device power, lots of other kind of variables. Then we have cloud services. Of course, as I said, like the data model is this kind of integrated client service kind of concept. So client side is the client side. We have the equivalent server side, which we call RCC, Roblox Cloud Compute. And this is server side part of the Roblox engine. And then we have, of course, a lot of services. Some are internal. I kind of talked about the asset service, for example, but you can imagine, as in any kind of modern platform, we have myriads of them. And on top of that, we have services that we give to game developers. So we provide analytics, we provide ways to like persist things in data stores, marketplace, things like that. And the last part of the platform is the studio. And the studio is also very interesting. The studio, of course, is where those virtual worlds are created. So it allows for easy editing of the data model. It freezes simulation. In a way, it allows you to set the starting condition if you want, if you wish. But even this is a little bit peculiar. We don't think the studio has really an editor and then we have a runtime. Really, the core concept of the platform is that we have this metaverse and then we have different clients into the metaverse. So the client that you have on your phone is one of which is just a play-only interpreter. The studio, though, is also a client. It just uses the very same concepts, but it changes the UI to make editing of them better. But really, there is nothing in the data model, or very little, very few things in the data model are editable only by the studio. Most of the data model objects are themselves dynamic. They can always change. They can change by scripts. And the studio just provides a very efficient interface for you to change them directly. This is also a very important design decision for us because we want, if there is anything that can be changed, anything that has dynamic properties, we want that creative aspect to exist not only inside the studio, which makes it very convenient, but also as a fundamental primitive for the metaverse itself. So say that we have a terrain, right? You can create the terrain in studio, but the exact same API that the studio uses to set terrain shapes can be used by scripts in game to dynamically make those changes. This allows you not only to have words that are much richer because they are always dynamic, but also create words that themselves have editors built in. And this happens quite often. Like there are games that they have their own asset catalogs. There are games that are themselves creative. Like you can imagine maybe something like, I don't know, SimCity if you wish, to the degree that you could even pop a text editor and have people create scripts as part of a place and then just execute the scripts. So even the programming part is not limited to be studio only. And then, of course, there is the community. So our role here is that we just try to shape the rules and define what those primitives of the metaverse are, but we really don't want to create content. We really don't want to favor an art style. It could be much faster for us to do that, like reach some results that look great if we like just hire professional artists to flood our toolbox with content. But it's really not what our long-term vision is. And interestingly enough, like I was then again talking about how our studio is a little bit of a hybrid. Studio itself wants to foster a community experience. So we have a concept called Team Create, where multiple people can jump into a studio session and go around and create together a virtual world. We want studio itself to be fun, to be a fun experience. And of course, we have what we call a toolbox, where creators can take section of what they made, like literally subtrees of the data model, package it and share it for other people to reuse. So this is the first real key concept. We have this metaverse. The metaverse is description language of virtual worlds, object materials, things like that. They live in a simulated physical universe. So by default, if you create something, it follows a very strong default set of rules. And then pretty much everything is hackable. So you can use scripting, most things are dynamic, and most of the built-in system that we provide can be disabled, and you can do absolutely what you want inside the worlds that you're creating. And this metaverse is really our priority. So we will never prioritize concepts that make the life of either the client or the studio easier if they are not appropriate description of virtual worlds. I'll make a quick example here. If I have to think about a very general and simple concept to display a 3D object, as a rendering engineer, I think, well, what if I have a tuple of a bunch of triangles on one hand, like vertex buffer, pixel vertex shaders, bunch of resources, textures. So this is kind of very simple abstraction of a draw hole. I can do this and create 3D worlds through concepts that are like this. But then are those really metaverse concepts? Well, I would say no, because now you have a rendering concept, a draw hole. You don't know anything about this. You don't know what you're rendering. You don't know what those shaders mean. They don't have like a physical meaning. They don't describe an object. So we don't do this. A more appropriate concept would be something like, well, we have a primitive, say a cube, of a given material, say gold. Well, this sounds more like a primitive universal concept that we want to have in our metaverse. And fun fact, this is exactly how Roblox works. And meshes, what we call mesh parts, are actually a very recent concept for us. We, for the longest time, only had primitives. We have a CSG engine. We opened mesh parts only in 2016 for people to just import external meshes. All right, so this is kind of why I say in the title, across space and time, because our client really is tasked to create a view, like make this metaverse real. Take a description that is universal, that fundamentally describes 3D worlds, and create a representation in terms of an image that you can interact with on your phone. The metaverse itself is shaped in a way that is not linked to specific technology. Its concepts are not concepts of rendering technology, they're concepts about describing physical worlds. And the concepts are meant to be universal. This also allows us to change technology. So this is where the across space and time comes in. Across space, I mean, across our device landscape. The same world can look significantly different if you have a very powerful console or if you have a relatively cheap tablet or a cheap phone. And across time, we continuously evolve our technology. And so, I don't know, a block of gold that you made 10 years ago, if you load it in current Roblox, it will look significantly different. The same is for everything, right? Like as we have better and better physical simulation, better and better rendering technology, so is our kind of window in the metaverse evolving. So this key principle of really caring about the metaverse has some interesting side effects, interesting to me at least. The first one is that it makes creation a lot easier. This is by two factors, I believe. The first one is that most of the reason why creating virtual worlds is complicated is because artists have to consider the technology that they are using. A lot of real-time rendering work, a lot of real-time art for real-time is really art that exists in a given technology. And you have to continuously battle those technological limitations. The other reason why creation is easier is because we provide, then again, a very strong default set of rules. So if you create something, it's not just a cube of gold, but it's also respecting physical properties. Like by default, it works in a way that makes sense, that is in a way unsurprising. And then if it's not to your liking, well, you have scripts and you can hack it away, right? It makes sharing easier, because now if you created an asset, because those assets rely on those more universal concepts, chances are that when you import something that someone else made, it will work in your game, because that thing wasn't made thinking of relying on a lot of custom code, a lot of custom concepts that exist only in that game, only in that place. They were made inside of our metaverse, and so chances are that it will be reusable. And it, then again, this is really actually true. Our toolbox has lots of things like, say, guns or cars or houses. And if you drag them, because they don't serialize just meshes, but entire chunks of the data model, you drop them in your place, and chances are that cars will work, that they will drive, you can sit in them, guns will make things explode, and so on and so forth. And the last thing that it's interesting that I already kind of talked about is that the quality is not fixed. As we progress technology, as you get more powerful devices, our view into the metaverse similarly improves. You can see there made like just some screenshot of our terrain system across actually a few different years. And you can see how the terrain like looks completely different, going from almost blocky look to start having some shader to have start having screen space reflections, nicer material blends to today where we even like add procedural decoration on top of certain materials. And we can do that because that is not just a mesh. It's, in our case, voxels carrying materials. So we know that someone made a patch of grass and a patch of rock, and we can interpret those with higher fidelity as time evolves. So this should kind of provide the context of our problem space. And when I think of it, it's almost hilariously opposite of how or my experience making AAA console games. So in AAA, you have a product, but it's more or less what ships in the Blu-ray, even if games now are a continuous experience with content that gets updated, but still you ship your game at a given date, right? And it's really a fixed target. You have one product, more or less at a given point in time, typically on one or very few devices, especially if you're a console developer, and you go to such intricate detail that like you want to have all the control of exactly where you place everything. You have very strong game direction, very strong art direction, and control is really what matters. And what's going on? Oops, I think we have to do a cut here because I don't know why the slides skip this way. The slides are all messed up. Let me exit the presentation here.
So we will make cut here, yeah?
Yeah, well, we clearly have to. So they're not messed up in my keynote. Mm-hmm. Like they're in the right sequence. I'll try to play again from here and see if it decides to collaborate.
Okay.
No. Oh. Oh, this is a conundrum. Like, I'll move the window here. This is the slide that should be next. I don't know what's going on. Let me try to save this file again.
Yeah, no problem.
Duplicate. Force copy, that's fine. Fine. Save. No. Okay. Oh no, I see the problem. I don't know how this happened, just a second. Okay. All right, it's also in a bunch of other slides. Okay, now it should be fine.
Okay.
Save this again, play. Okay, is it working?
Yes.
All right, okay, so let's start again from here. And I think I finished this slide. All right. Well, for us, for Roblox, well, our product is this very long-term vision of what the metaverse is. And we really don't have a single target or no target at all. We have millions of places of all kinds. It's forever evolving. We support literally tens of thousands of different devices. And what we want to prioritize is understanding the creative intent over precise control. That is because we want to be able to hallucinate detail depending on the platform. We want to be able to improve things in the future. And so we have to know not just that you're rendering a mesh, but that you're creating a body of water. And this goes even to the kind of day-to-day production, if you wish. If you work on a game, typically changing technology is fairly hard, especially late in production, because you have hundreds of artists that created content that was really specific to a given technology. If you want to change things, people are going to be upset. But if you want to add more options, that typically is not a problem. If you want to have three more sliders for something, well, you work with a lead artist to make sure that they have the sliders that they want. But other than that, it's not a big deal. For us, it's exactly the opposite. If you want to change technology, is relatively easy, meaning it's just an engineering thing. And well, of course, you have to take care of not breaking the platform or making things worse. But there aren't really constraints. If you want to add something, then we have to be very careful, because adding concepts to our data model, to our description of the metaverse, well, now we have to make sure that those things are things that can live for a long time. We do deprecate APIs. It's not that everything always survives, but we really strive for those concepts to be universal. And so Roblox is really tech agnostic. I say, if not downright hostile. We don't think about creating concepts that are easy to render, easy to simulate, but that are appropriate for what we want to do. So what happens is that everything is dynamic. We don't have concept of static anything, because hints that things are static don't sound really like a primitive concept. Everything is physically simulated, of course. A model is just a collection of parts, and parts stick together with physical constraints, and those constraints can be broken. It's just one of many examples. We don't like to have baking, because everything is dynamic. We don't allow people to create things like colliders or occluders or portals. Those are all technological concepts. They are not primitives that make into our worlds. We don't want people to have explicit control over LODs, over shaders. And we are not even aiming for a simple or stylized kind of look. We really want to aim for photorealism. So it's really a very hostile environment in some ways. So how do we cope with all this? Well, those are some of our key rendering ideas. First of all, we kind of resign to abandon the idea of making things optimally. We don't even have a target. It's truly a challenging problem to understand performance across such a number of worlds and devices. We focus instead on scalability. So a lot of rendering systems are based on budgets and incremental computation and caching, where things eventually converge. We work always on top of an abstraction, so we never reference the underlying API. We have our own abstraction, which is called GFX Core. It's in the style of DirectX 11. Of course, we also cross-compile our shaders, and we have caps bit for functionality. So if you want to use a rendering path that, say, wants to use occlusion queries, you ask our abstraction layer if those things are available, and from there on, you write your code, but you don't know that it will be this API or this other API. And we want to keep things always working. So regardless of your device, our window into the world should work. What we don't promise is fidelity. So if you don't have enough memory, if you don't have enough performance, then that window will shrink. Maybe you will not be able to see very far ahead in our worlds, or see something that has degraded quality, inferior kind of lighting, but still it provides a view into a virtual world that you want to explore. And this also is important because we don't know the complexity of those worlds. So it's not just about device power, but it's because people could make things that are incredibly complicated, and we have to find ways of coping with that. And the last thing is that because the metaverse concepts are almost never rendering concepts, everything in the data model likely doesn't correspond one-to-one with things that we create on the rendering backend. And we will have a couple of examples to kind of explain what we mean with this. So let's have a look a little bit about our engine architecture. The engine works in main kind of threading models, fairly simple. We have kind of old school simulation rendering thread for a few reasons. A lot of our devices are not many core, but also it's because there are many points at which scripts can bind and change data, and we really don't want to deal with that complexity. So what we have is a kind of pool model where you can register listeners to changes in the data model, and at a given point, the rendering thread write locks the data model, grabs all the deltas as fast as possible, grabs everything that changed, releases the lock, and then all those changes start to be processed on worker threads as we create new rendering data structures and kick the next frame. And the engine really is based on what we call clusters. And what we call cluster is everything that we draw, because as I was mentioning, the data model concepts are really not matched one-to-one with what we want to do in terms of draws. We don't really have ways of rendering a single thing. So all our rendering systems are based on the concept of aggregating data model objects into bigger clusters for rendering. And there are a bunch of those clusters, but the two main ones that render both kind of what we call parts, primitives, and mesh parts, external meshes, are called fast clusters and instance clusters. Some other example, we have a system called smooth cluster, which is really our voxel terrain system. We have a bunch of other things, but the idea is that all those systems listen to changes, aggregating to create rendering primitives, draw calls for the GPU. So let's have a look at the two main ones. First is the fast clusters, and this is the system that is supported on all devices. The idea here is basically CPU software kind of instancing. So as geometry moves around, gets created, we try to create on the fly index or vertex buffers to aggregate meshes, to aggregate objects into bigger chunks of geometry. And of course, we have heuristics on how to split and aggregate things. So We divide very small and very large parts into different cells. We have a special case for our humanoids, for our characters. If things start moving, we create what we call dynamic fast clusters, which are basically draws that pass up to 72 transforms as constants. And we also, in the fast cluster system, lift some material properties into vertex data to further avoid breaking batches, breaking locals. Now, this system is very great. It works on any device. It doesn't rely on really any hardware instancing, but it has a couple of downsides. One downside is to continuously create this new index or vertex buffer. Well, this is expensive. And anytime that something is expensive in our engine, well, what we do is that we do it incrementally over time. So we set a budget in milliseconds. If we don't manage to catch up with the data model change, we'll process the remaining in the next frames and hope that things stop moving eventually. Cute example of going with a rocket launcher and destroying things, and you can kind of see how the clusters recluster around the dynamic geometry. All right. I have even a more extreme example here. This is really a complicated case because with physics, you can see how the clusters are continuously being reclustered. And then more recently, what we introduced is this other concept called instance clusters. And this is something that we enable on devices that have working efficient hardware instancing. So, well, as you might imagine, this system, instead of creating vertex and index buffers, uses instancing to batch things together. In theory, this could lead to a situation where things may not batch as aggressively, but in practice, it's both rare for this to happen, and it's not as much of a problem because we rely that the devices that have these hardware capabilities can also cope with a little bit more throttles. The instance clusters, very interesting, I think. They use a hybrid approach where we do both static and dynamic instancing. And what does it mean is that when we detect that clusters are big enough on their own, then we prepare a buffer with all the instance data, we upload it on the GPU, and we use that to draw. But we still may have some clusters that are very small or even individual meshes around that didn't manage to enter any of the bigger clusters. And this happens all the time with transparencies because we have to sort them so they change every frame and they really can't be into any of the static clusters. So for those kind of remainder meshes, what we do is that we create a dynamic buffer and we put all those into a dynamic buffer to still not issue single draw calls for those remaining objects. This is a huge win. As I said, most of the time it even results in less draw calls. But the other really important win is that it uses much less memory. And so we can push the view distance and push the work complexity much farther when we have the availability of instance clusters. And this is kind of an example of what I was saying, like scalable over optimal. Profiling things at scale is extremely challenging. We are pushing data analytics more and more to try to understand how we perform in practice across devices and across games. But if you don't delve down into the analytics and you just do an engine change, chances are that we have so many devices and so many places that some go faster, some go slower, and you don't see a change when you look at average of frame per seconds, unless you really drill down into the specifics. And of course, we do spot test at our desks on a bunch of devices, but we can only do so far, right? Like, it's not really representative. So performance for us has primarily been about trying to make things cached and scalable. All right, so there is a lot, of course, to cover in the engine. It's fairly sizable by now. It's been evolving for the past 12 years. So I won't cover all of that, but I want just to show some of the scalability concepts when it comes to actual rendering features. So instance of fast cluster are engine concepts, are the primary ways in which we issue draw calls, but they're not really rendering features. Rendering features typically depend on device capability. Sometimes we do not enable some features on older APIs because we assume that those devices are not powerful enough. Some features may rely on having instance cluster working. It's kind of similar reasoning. We think that we believe instance cluster will be enabled on more powerful devices. And so sometimes there are features that are not worth to backport to the fast cluster system because those devices will probably not be able to have enough power to support them anyways. And then we have a concept of quality level and a frame rate manager, because even if you have all the APIs and very powerful devices, you still don't know, like places may be so complicated that you still have to scale down and use some of the cheaper rendering techniques to render specific places. So let's do an example, how we do lighting. And this, then again, it's a little bit tricky. We evolve quite a bit. If you think about it, the engine itself changed its rendering infrastructure completely at least three times. Like we started from licensing G3D, then we had like a short stint with Ogre, and then we created our own, what we call GFX Core or an abstraction, GFX Render, which is a rendering system. The rendering features change even more because they're just technology. We can, any new release may have like new kind of capability. And of course, you can imagine there are lots of different subsystems that go into creating a thermal frame. So here I want to just show two of the primary lighting backends that we have implemented. And similar to fast cluster and instance cluster, I will present first the one that covers all devices, and then we will see what we do into the devices that are a little bit more capable and a little bit more performant. So the system that is kind of our baseline is what we call voxel lighting. And it's also kind of fun fact, as far as I know, Roblox was one of the very first mobile titles to have dynamic lighting. So how do we achieve this? Well, then again, the theme is find ways of caching and computing things incrementally. When we thought about that, well, we considered, well, maybe caching lighting or computing lighting in voxels may be a good bet. And there were already some titles doing this. An example would be Little Big Planet on PlayStation 3, which has a GPU kind of voxel lighting system. Seemed doable. We separated out the character shadows because characters go around that all the time, so they would invalidate voxels all the time. But we started having a spin on this. So first thing that it's quite unique in our system is that it's a voxel lighting system that is not GPU based, and instead it computes all the lighting on CPU. And we have a reference implementation in C++, and then we have a bunch of CMD optimized version of it. This goes for the rasterizer that takes all the parts and meshes and creates occluders in a voxel grid. We also are kind of peculiar in how we represent occlusion, because the voxel grid really doesn't have a lot of resolution. If you just add a binary in or out, it would create a lot of light leaks. We found that storing occlusion projected by the area that it occludes on the three world axis works much better for us. And then once we have occlusion, we compute three lighting textures. So we have one where we store all what we call local lighting, all the lights that are not sun, and we store directly the lighting intensity at voxels for those. Then we have a concept of sky visibility, which is, if you wish, sort of like an ambient occlusion term, how much the sky is occluded at a given voxel. And then we store separately sun shadows. And this is because our sun, even with voxel lighting, is analytic. and only the shadows are computed in voxels. How this works? Well, voxels are divided in clusters. The clusters are our unit of update. And then again, it's incremental. We have a budget. We process clusters until we reach a number of milliseconds. If we exceed that, we bail out and we compute the rest in the next frame. Clusters overlap by one voxel, so they have skirts, and those skirts allow communication. So when an interface changes more than a threshold, it kicks the invalidation of the adjacent cluster. And the lighting process itself, if you wish, it's kind of inspired by light propagation volumes. It's a diffuse process, and we support directional spot, omnilight. We'll see a little bit how it works. The computation itself, because it's a diffusion process, the order of voxels as they're computed in a cluster depends on the light direction. So let's start with the simplest thing as an example, skylight occlusion. In this case, what we do really is average the occupancy for each voxel of the 9 voxels above it. So in this case, the computation proceeds simply top down. We start from the topmost voxels in a cluster and then we go down. The average is weighted by in ways that take into consideration the occlusion projection as I was describing before. It's not very important. For lights, like take sunlight, well, now the order of update depends on the light direction and actually in which octant that light direction falls. And in that case, each voxel takes for the shadows, right, takes the average of the 3 voxels in the octant of the light direction. And kind of similarly works the propagation of lighting information. If we have omnilights, it's a very similar process, but we repeat it once per each octant because of course omnilights go in all directions. All right, so this is a short tour of how this crazy voxel lighting system works. After we completed that, then we started thinking, well, what we can do if we have a little bit more power. We ran a Hackwick where we experiment with GPU voxel lighting system. And the idea there was to allow to have much higher resolution to cascade the voxels. In the end, we decided to shelve that initiative. And this is actually another interesting thing, like a lot, really more than half of our rendering features really come from our Hackwicks. So maybe we'll resurrect this idea in the future. The idea that started to be implemented, on the other hand, was to try to think, okay, if you have a little bit more power, can we cache less? Can we maybe cache only shadows? So our new backend relies on shadow maps, but we cache them in tiles. We have like a standard EVSM. The idea there is that we can both have sharp shadows and we can keep the register pressure a little bit lower in our forward pass. They're always updated in tiles. And of course, for the sun, we also use cascades. So how we do shading on top of this? Well, ordinarily the lights, be with the shadow maps or only the sun in case we have voxel lightings, I use PBR. PBR in our world, well, we developed an approximation of GGX with energy conservation. And we have another approximation that realizes spherical Gaussians for low-end devices. And so now if you have like all those components, you have voxel lighting, you have shadow maps, you have shadow maps on the sun, we have shadow maps on all our local lights, we can combine those features based on your device capability. So from kind of lowest to highest quality, the cheapest thing that we can render, we use voxel lighting, analytic sun, voxel shadows, and the ambient term is an indoor-outdoor ambient that is based on the voxel sky visibility. If you have a little bit more compute power or if your places are simpler, then we start adding environment lighting to have a better kind of ambient term. And still we differentiate between indoor and outdoor using the voxel sky occlusion. Next step up, we start not using the voxel shadows for the sun, but instead our tiled, cascaded EVSM shadow maps. And lastly, if you really have something powerful, then we switch to full forward plus backend, where all the lights are analytics, they all have shadow maps with EVSM, and of course, using our tiled system that allows us to compute that across frames. All right, so this is kind of the end of the presentation. There are, as you can imagine, then again, a lot more systems that I didn't cover, but I really didn't want to go into the specifics of how we render a frame in Roblox. That wasn't my objective. What I wanted to show is, well, first of all, that we have something here that uses a lot of familiar rendering concepts, GGX, EVSM, lots of things that are in the literature, and a lot of unorthodox solution. And the reason why is that we really, I believe, are in a fairly unique problem space. This idea of metaverse is king is a very interesting constraint. It's a really great concept for both creativity and for enabling our community. It's very interesting that it decouples so strongly our worlds from the technology that visualizes it. And in a way, it allows this technology to evolve much more freely. And this has been the case for the past 10 years. Roblox is a very long-lived platform. So I wonder where we will go in the next 10 years. Some ideas is that we want to shift to leverage more our crowd processing. We definitely want to hallucinate more detail, pushing more the procedural generation. This is both good in terms of quality, but also to allow to not need to deploy or stream a lot of data to the clients. And for the future, the idea is like, can authoring still be completely tech agnostic? And can we push even more the incremental kind of computation angle so that you can really create words that are as complicated as you want and they always work and we just scale the fidelity on different devices. This is the end. I have to thank both Arsene and Sergey that both reviewed the slides and provided some of the material. And if you're kind of, if this piqued your interest, then I strongly suggest to have a look at the many presentations that Arsene have done through the years that focus on much more specifics of aspects of technology, our GFX core implementation, our Vulkan support, a lot of deep dives into the tech power in Roblox. We also have our own kind of tech blog. It describes, for example, some of the work that we've been doing with the GGX approximation. And we have a few talks in other conferences that you can have a look as well if this looks interesting to you. And I think that I have to mention, we are always hiring. Thank you.